The Valley of Jehoshaphat. For there I will sit to judge all the heathen round about. Put ye in the sickle for the harvest is ripe. Come get you down, for the press is full. The fats overflow. Their wickedness is great. Multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
You want to have a song request?
Yes, I have one this morning. It's in the Knowles book, The Sun's Coming Up. It's on page 148.
Oh Lord my God, when
Ray, I would like to ask prayer. grandchildren. All of them's lost except for one. And pray for my son, both my sons. They're lost.
Amen.
And pray for my family. You know, we're to pray for one another.
Amen.
And hold them up. Even though I'm not in charge, I still pray for my Christian family.
Amen.
You know, I pray for anybody in any church because God's in all of them.
That's right.
And, you know, when it says at the end of time, it'll be brother against brother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law. You know, all these things are happening. Jesus is even at the door.
Yeah.
You know, just like you, I've watched, looked at that picture up front behind you many times. Jesus is knocking on each and every door this morning. And you know, there's not a handle on there, so Jesus will not open that door himself. You have to open up your heart.
Amen.
And let him walk in. And you know, you'll be a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things pass away and all things become new.
Amen.
And you know, there's strength in numbers. And you know, we need to glorify God more. We need the churches that I have heard from, not to say any in particular, they say that their attendance has fallen off. They say that the people don't want to stand and worship God anymore. But you know, praise God, I'm going to worship Him through my trials, through
Amen.
My troubles. I'm going to turn my radio on when Satan says, you ain't going to make it. And then I get my Bible and Jesus says, I am a way maker. So you all just pray for me. There's a lot of things going on health-wise. God knows all about it. Told the doctor I can't go through it again. But you know what? If I go through it again, Jesus is going to go with me.
Amen.
So you all just pray for my family, and I will pray for you all. And remember, Liam, it's not here. Mike, it's not here this morning. And she requested last week, brother, prayer
yeah.
for her brother and her nephew. That's been on me all week about her brother and her
yeah.
nephew. And pray for the family that got burned out, that Aunt Jean was talking about, Jesse, that used to be the preacher here. Liam, I mean, Aunt Jean.
Yeah.
And just keep that family in prayer. And bless you, Ray Ray.
You know, the fella that contacted us over the internet, his name's Robert Stogsdale. And I just come to find out this past week that he's unemployed. He doesn't have a job. And he said that he's struggling with particular different sins in his life, and he wants to be obedient, and he asked the church to pray for him, that the Lord would help him to overcome that sin. And you know, the Lord's put it on my heart for him, Lord, to help him find a job. You know, God wants us to cast all of our care upon him, and for he cares for us, and you know, the Lord's able to find to give this man a job and for, to find. And I believe he has a heart for the Lord. I believe he has a hunger for the Word of God, and it's important that, as our sister said, to pray for one another. And the Bible says that the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much.
Amen.
And that's God's promise, is that it will avail much when we pray for one another fervently. And I thank the Lord for the privilege that we can pray for one another. So remember Robert, remember his situation, and I pray that someday the Lord may allow him to come and visit here. He said that he's going to come here and visit
Bless
one day.
The Lord.
And he said that he's very thankful for the witness this little church provides. And I want you to know that you know, that God's family is not sparse and it's not few. We have members of God's church worldwide.
Amen.
And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful to be a part of the family of God.
Hallelujah.
I'm so glad, amen,
yes,
that amen. The Bible says that in the future, when we are around the throne of God, that there will be thousands upon thousands and ten thousands upon thousands and thousands saying, worthy is the
Hallelujah.
Lamb. I'm so glad.
Yes, Lord.
Amen, for who he is. And I just bless his holy name this morning for being my Savior and my friend. He's with me everywhere I go. He's there with me in the middle of the night, and he's there with me when I wake in the morning. He's with me all throughout the day. And I thank God for that comfort. that he gives us in him. And I praise the Lord for that this morning. We all have prayer. Father Almighty, in the name of Jesus, we're so thankful, Father, for your wonderful name. Lord, we're so thankful for who you are. Lord God, we praise you from the depths of our heart and soul, Father God, Lord, for your sacrifice that you gave, dear Lord, and sending your Son to die for our sin, my Father. Lord God, that you didn't spare him, but Father, that you gave him, dear Lord, willingly, Father. Lord, I just thank you, dear Lord God, that it pleased you, Father God, Lord, for him to take our sin away, Father. Lord, we praise you, dear Lord, this morning for the privilege of coming to worship you, Father. Lord, we just thank you, dear Lord God, that we worship you each and every day, Lord God. Father, Lord, as we're living throughout this life, dear Lord, that you've given us, Father. Lord, we just pray this morning, Father, for our brothers and sisters of Christ, dear Lord, for Lord, you told us that if we would delight ourselves in you, that you would give us the desires of our heart. And Lord, truly our desire, dear Lord, is to see salvation, dear Lord, of those that are lost, dear Lord, Sister Campbell's family, dear Lord, her grandchildren, Father. Lord, we just thank you, my Savior God, Lord, for saving them and drawing them, dear Lord God, with your Spirit. Father God, Lord, we pray for the ones that Sister Imogene mentioned, Father. Lord God, for those that have lost their home, dear Lord God. And Lord, we pray for Sister Leona, dear Lord, and her request. And for Nancy, dear Lord God. And we just pray, Father, Lord, that we might be a witness, dear Lord God, that this little light would shine, dear Lord God. And Father God, Lord, that we wouldn't let the discouragement or the darkness of this world, Father God, Lord, to quench that light and that zeal that you've given us, Father. Lord God, we pray this morning for Robert, dear Lord. We pray that, Lord God, that you would help him to draw nigh unto you, Father. Lord God, with your Spirit, that you would reveal your word unto him. And Father, that you would feed him and nourish him, dear Lord God, with your scriptures and with your truth, Father. Lord God, we just know that you'll supply all of our need according to your riches. Lord God, we just want to thank you for that this morning. Thank you for helping us, dear Lord God, to serve and worship and honor you, Father.
And Father, we give you all the praise and glory forevermore. Thank you for the blood that covers us. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy, your grace. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you're our strength when we're in trouble. Thank you, God, that you are everything. You are all in all. There's no God like you, Jehovah, the one true living God. And, Lord, you're the same God all over the world. Father God, I just pray that you'll pour down your anointing upon every church, Lord, and awakening, Lord, because it won't be long, because you're coming back to get us, Lord. And Father God, you said that in your word that you cannot lie and you will not lie, that you are truth. And Father God, we know the knowledge of truth is what sets us free. It's not just the truth, Father God. We know it's the knowledge of the truth. And thank you for that, Father God. Thank you for my husband. Thank you for my children, Lord. And Father God, they said I'd never be a mother, but Father God, you seen that I was. Lord, I didn't think I'd have children, but there again, Lord, you blessed me with children. And Lord, just bless this church and bless Jim this morning, Lord. And it's just a blessing to hear him talk about Israel this morning, Lord, and I long to hear that, and just be with the children here this morning, Lord, and just, God, we trust you with everything, and we just want to give you all that's in us this morning, in Jesus' name, amen.
In Psalms 48, the Bible has a song there, and it's been on my heart all morning long, and I just want to maybe lead out, and if y'all can follow along. It just two verses there, and I'm sure you're familiar with it. And so let's just sing that a few times, maybe two or three times, and let's give God glory and praise. It goes, great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole world is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great King. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. In the city of our God, in the mountain of His holiness, beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole world is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great King. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. In the city of our God, in the mountain of His holiness, beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole world.
Hallelujah.
Is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great King.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for saving us.
Yes,
Lord. I just like Sam to say this morning that I love you.
Bless you, son.
Bless you. And I know you love us from me, because He takes care of us.
Amen.
And I can thank Him enough for
that. That's right, brother. Bless Jesus.
And I just want to thank Him. Thank for each and every one of y'all for your prayers, because I know they're being answered.
Amen.
So just pray for me. You're strong.
Bless you, Brother Bob. Amen. Amen.
Now we've been talking about obedience. Who can tell me what obedience is? What does it mean to be obedient? What's that mean? If you obey me, what are you doing? You're doing what you're told, right? Okay. Who does God want us to obey? Okay. And who? Him. Obey God. How should we obey Him? Well, should we obey Him by saying, all right? We should obey willingly.
Amen.
Okay. When should we obey Him?
Immediately.
Who's going to try to deceive us and try to get us to not obey Him? Satan, right. What do we need to use when we're tempted to disobey?
The Word of the Lord.
Yes.
Right,
amen.
The Word of the Lord. We're to look in Scripture and find guidance from Scripture. Now there's going to be times that we're going to face times when we're still not going to be sure what God wants us to do. And we're going to look and see what happened when Jesus was faced with a time when He wasn't sure. He was looking for guidance from God. And we're going to look in Matthew chapter 26. Look right up here. There's 24, 25, 26. We're going to start at verse 36. Okay, I'm going to read, and you guys follow along, and I'll have you guys read parts. Then cometh Jesus with them, these are His disciples, unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, Sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, Autumn, read that part, what he said to Peter. Ray, read verse 41.
Watch and pray that ye
enter not
into
temptation.
The
spirit
inherited
indeed
is willing, but
flesh is weak. Okay. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, Autumn, you read the rest of 42. Oh, my Father. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again, and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then cometh he to his disciples, and saith unto them, Sleep on now, and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. So was Jesus excited about what was about? He knew that he was going to be arrested, that he was going to be crucified. Do you think he was excited about that?
No.
He wasn't. He wasn't excited about that. How do you think he felt?
Sad.
Says that he was sorrowful. He was exceeding sorrowful. he knew it was going to be painful. He knew that his mother was going to be sad, that it was going to be painful for her to see this happen to him. So he wasn't sure. Well, he said, My Father, if this cup may not pass away from me. So he was going to God, and he was asking God for guidance. He was asking God for comfort. So that's what we need to do when we're faced with times, when we're not sure and we feel like maybe we should give up. Maybe we, we're not sure what God wants us to do. What does he want us to do? He wants us to pray. He wants us to go to him and seek comfort for him, seek guidance from him. There are going to be times when you guys are going to face things, and you're going to face difficult times. What's something difficult that you've done that that it was just really hard, that maybe you felt like giving up? How about riding a bike? That was kind of hard, learning how to ride a bike, wasn't it? Did you feel like giving up? I mean, that sometimes you probably get frustrated and get upset about it, and you feel like just giving up. What's something else that maybe you faced that's been difficult? Something that you've went through, or something that you've tried to do that you felt like giving up?
Trying to get the mats out of Maggie's hair.
Mats out of Maggie's hair. Yeah, those mats just won't come out. You just got to keep going, don't you?
You also need a cup.
Yeah. you know, I dealt with, you know, I used to smoke, and it was really hard to quit smoking, and I had quit many times, and I would give up, and I would say, all right, this is just too hard. I can't do this. I'm just going to give up, and I would give up, and then I'd have to start all over again, and finally, I was able to do it because God helped me.
Amen.
God gave me the strength. I asked him, and he knew I couldn't do it on my own, but he wanted me to go to him and ask him for help, and he helped me, and he made it easy. Yeah. It wasn't hard. It was easy. I should have went to him a long time ago and asked him for help because, you know, I thought I could do it on my own, and I couldn't do it on my own. I had to do it with his help.
Preaching's the same way. Now, there's been times that I wanted to give up preaching.
Yeah.
And I felt worthless that I couldn't do it anymore. And I'm telling you, and you know as well as I do, that I'd lay there all night awake and wouldn't be able to sleep, and the devil just wear me plumb out. And I'd replay things that I thought were foolish over and over in my mind about how big of a blunder I made of myself.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the enemy would tell me. But I realized more and more to just trust Jesus.
Amen.
And just call on Jesus.
Amen.
And just get in God's word.
Bless him, Lord.
And believe God's word.
Amen.
And before I know it, that devil, he runs.
Hallelujah.
And glory
yes,
to God.
Does.
God gives you
Amen.
The anointing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's easy. It's not
mm-hmm.
as hard anymore.
Bless the Lord.
And God makes it easy. That's what the anointing does, is he makes it where we can accomplish his work. The Bible says that we have an unction from the Holy One.
Amen.
You have to rebuke Satan in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
And he has to flee.
Amen.
I didn't think to interrupt.
Bless
no,
God.
No, no, no. I'm not interrupting. So Jesus shows us in this scripture, you know, he was sorrowful. He wasn't excited about this was something hard that he was going to have to do. He was going to have to carry the burden of sin of the whole world. Not just one sin or two sins. He was carrying the burden for all sin. Sin, just sin. He was carrying, he had to carry that. And he knew it was going to be hard. And people made fun of him, and besides beating him, they, you know, he was humiliated, but he didn't give up, did he?
Amen.
We would be in terrible shape if he did. And he could have. He could have given up, but he didn't give up.
Amen.
What did he do before? What did he do? Where did he seek guidance from? Who did he seek guidance from? God, the Father. He sought guidance from his Father. How did he talk to his Father? How did he talk to God?
Pray.
He prayed. He prayed. And that's what we need to do.
Amen.
We're turning your Bibles to Philippians chapter 4.
Verse 6. Amen.
Okay. You want to read it, Autumn?
Sure.
What? Chapter 4, Philippians chapter 4. Go to verse 6. Go up to the top. Right side. Yep, up there. Verse 6. Okay. Autumn, you read that.
Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer.
Keep going.
Page.
Oh, okay, sorry.
And supplication. And supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known.
So what should we care about? What should we be careful for? Nothing.
Amen.
Nothing. In everything, by prayer and supplication.
Amen.
With thanksgiving.
Amen.
We should pray with thanksgiving. We should pray already thanking Him for what He's done, for what He, how He has helped us to get through it. We should pray. We should have thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord, for answering this prayer that I'm praying to you right at this very moment. Because I know that you're going to help me. That's how He tells us that He wants us to pray. We're going to, you know, sometimes we're going to feel anxious about things. We're going to feel, you know, not sure what God wants us to do. You know, we've read in His scripture and to try to seek guidance, but sometimes we're still not going to be sure because our flesh is weak.
Amen.
So He wants us to go to Him. He knows that our flesh is weak, and He wants us to go to Him for help. So we have, we've used some scriptures through the past few weeks about obedience, and we're going to go and read back through them again, okay? So turn first to Ephesians 6. Verses 1 through 3. You need help, sis? Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. Okay. Turn to the Gospel of John, not 1st, 2nd, or 3rd John, but the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Chapter 14. Okay, find verse 15. Okay, Ray Ray, you read that.
If you love me, keep my commandments.
So if we love God, what are we going to do?
Keep His commandments.
Right. And what does that mean?
Obey.
We're going to obey Him. Okay, now turn to 1 Peter. Chapter 5, verse 8. He's telling us what we need to look out for. Autumn, you read that. Wait, Ray-Ray's late. Ray-Ray's still working. That's okay. chapter 5. Okay. Autumn, you read that.
Be sober.
Mm-hmm.
Be sober. Be vigilant. Because your
adversary.
The devil has a roaring lion.
Walker. Yes. So we're going to face temptations, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what are we to do? We need to be watchful. We need to be, we need to be aware and watch for temptation to happen because it's going to happen. Now turn to Philippians chapter 4.
Supplication with thanksgiving. Let your request be made known unto God.
So when we face temptation and we are not sure what we're to do, what God's will is, what are we supposed to do? We need to pray. We need to go to Him and talk to Him.
Amen.
He's your Father.
Amen.
Just like your daddy's your daddy, and you can go to him when you're having trouble or when you're worried about something. But you can also go to your heavenly Father. I can go to my heavenly Father. My earthly father is gone. He's with Jesus. But I can go to my heavenly Father. He's not going anywhere. He's always there for me, and I can always go to him. Now turn to 1 John. Yeah, the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John.
1st John, your
chapter 5.
Five.
Yeah, starting at verse 1. Now I'm going to read this, and then we're going to go through the verse that we need to memorize. You read in just a minute. I'm going to give you the part for you to read. You want to read that whole thing?
Yeah.
If you want to read that whole thing, go ahead.
How big is it? Where did it go?
It's verses 1 through 5.
Okay. Whosoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loved him that
begat
love him. Also,
begotten
of him. But by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God?
Okay. Now the part that I want to wanted us to memorize. It's 1 John 5 and 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. Okay.
That's
the part that I want us to memorize.
Keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous.
For this is the love of God.
This is the love of God.
That we keep his commandments.
That we keep his commandments.
And his commandments are not grievous.
Okay?
Let's say it again. 1 John.
I want to touch that.
Okay.
1 John 5 through 3.
5 and 3.
5 and 3. For the love of God is his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous.
You've got a chunk of it.
For this is the love of God,
that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous.
Okay. Can I try one more time?
Yeah, try it again.
For this is the love of God, his His commandments,
that we keep
his commandments, and his commandments are not
grievous.
Grievous.
Okay. What does that mean that they're not grievous?
Painful.
Right. They're not burdensome. You know, the things that he tells us to do. They're going to make things better for us.
Amen.
When we obey his commandments. If we disobey him and go against the Lord, our life is going to be a lot harder. He says in that other verse that we read that it will be well with thee. It will go well with you, with thee, and your life, you know, you're going to live long. So his commandments are going to help us. Autumn, do you want to try it? 1 John 5 and 3.
For this is the love of God that we keep. This is the love of God that we keep his commandments, and his commands are our gifts.
Okay, try to say it without looking. 1 John.
1 John chapter 5, verses 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous.
Amen. Good job. Okay. We're going to start a different unit next week. Ooh. Attitude.
Can I
see one? Well, there's no picture here, see what? You can come look, but... Thank you.
2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms and Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts and Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st John, 2nd John, 3rd John, Jude and Revelation.
Good job.
We will roll the gospel chariot along. We will roll the gospel chariot along. We will roll the gospel chariot along. But we can't hang on behind. If the preacher's in the road, we will stop and pick him up. If the preacher's in the road, we will stop and pick him up. If the preacher's in the road, we will stop and pick him up, but we can't hang on behind. If the devil's in the road, we will roll right over him. If the devil's in the road, we will roll right over him. If the devil's in the road, we will roll right over him, but we can't hang on behind.
What else do I see?
How about the I don't know what you can do, but I can praise the Lord.
There we go. Okay.
I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. Yes, Jesus loves me. rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. And the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. And the house on the rock stood firm. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. And the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. And the house on the sand went splash! So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. And the blessings will come down. The blessings come down as the prayers go up. The blessings come down as the prayers go up. The blessings come down as the prayers go up. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. Deep and wide, deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. Deep and wide, deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. Wide and deep, wide and deep, there's a fountain flowing wide and deep. Wide and deep, wide and deep, there's a fountain flowing wide and deep.
How about page 1 in the red book, Someone to Care?
When the world seems cold and your friend seems few, there is someone who cares for you. When you've tears in your eyes, your heart bleeds inside, there is someone who
Praise the Lord. It's good to be saved.
Amen.
Amen. Y'all remember about Elijah?
Yeah.
And you remember about how that Elisha wanted to see him taken into heaven. And he said, the Bible told us that he said, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. And he said, thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. And it came to pass, as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. So, blessed be the name of the Lord. Elijah was taken to heaven.
Amen.
And to me, this is a type of being carried away. This is a type of rapture. And the Bible tells us that the folks that were there, they had a hard time believing it. They couldn't believe it. The Bible says in verse 15 that when the sons of the prophets which were to view at Jericho saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elisha. And they came to meet him and bowed themselves to the ground before him. And they said unto him, behold now, there is with thy servant 50 strong men. Let them go, we pray thee, and seek thy master, lest peradventure the spirit of the Lord hath taken him up and cast him upon some mountain.
Yeah.
That's what they said. They said, well, the Spirit of the Lord took him and cast him on some mountain somewhere. Well, he was on a mountain, but he wasn't the mountain they're thinking of. Or into some valley. And he said, ye shall not sin. Elisha said, don't do that. Don't go and send those men to do that. And when they urged him till he was ashamed, he said, go ahead. And they sent therefore 50 men, and they sought 3 days, but found him not. They looked for him for 350 men. They went combing the hillsides looking for Elijah. And they couldn't find him. And when they came again to him, for he tarried at Jericho, he said unto them, did I not say unto you, go not? Amen. He said, didn't I tell you? Don't go. You're wasting your time. Amen. He went to heaven.
Amen.
Glory be to God. You know the same thing is going to happen to us.
Praise God.
Jesus said, now Jesus referenced this, glory be to God, I've never seen this before. In John chapter 7, Jesus said that you'll seek me, but you'll not find me. And he says, and where I am, thither you cannot go. Glory be to God, there's going to be folks looking for us one day. They're going to be looking. Where's Gail at? Where's Jim at? Amen. Where's Troy at? Where's Brother Bob? And they're gone. Hallelujah. You can look for them. But you're not going to find them.
Hallelujah.
And glory be to God. I'm so glad. Amen. The Lord is going to take us home one day. I'm looking forward to it.
Amen.
Jesus said, whither I go, ye cannot come. Glory be to God. I'm so thankful that he has made a way that whosoever will can come to him. And we can know that, glory be to God, that we can go and be with him for eternity. We left off there last week in Revelation. We left off at the sixth seal. The Bible said that the men, the great men, the chief captains, the mighty men, the bond man, every free man, that they're going to hide themselves in the dens, in the rocks, in the mountains, and they're going to say to the rocks and the mountains, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. Now, amen, God has not appointed us unto wrath, amen. But he's appointed us to salvation.
Amen.
Amen. Isn't it good? You say, Brother Troy, what are you saved from? You're saved from sin.
Amen.
And amen, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life.
Hallelujah.
Through Jesus Christ, God's Son. And it's wonderful. It's wonderful to be saved. The Bible goes on and it says, For the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand. So we see that God's wrath is going to be opened upon this world. We see that God is a loving God. Yes, he is. And the Bible says that God is love. Amen. Everyone that is begotten by God loves, for God is love. Amen.
It's good to love everyone. It's good to love even those who consider themselves to be your enemy. Amen. You know you got the goods when you can truly love someone that doesn't love you back. You can, when you can truly like someone and say, look, I'm gonna pray for their soul and I'm gonna do everything I can to try to help this person. Amen. Because you care for their soul. David said that he looked on his right hand and his refuge failed him. He said, no man cared for my soul. But I tell you that there's one man that cares today. And his name is Jesus. Amen. I'm glad that Jesus cared for our soul enough to go to the cross and to die and to lay down his life willingly.
Amen.
He did it willingly. Amen. He said, no man takes my life from me. He says, I lay it down willingly. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. He received that commandment from his Father. And you know, God has called us to be lights and to be witnesses in this world. Amen. That is what God has called us to do.
Amen.
Even to those, to the heathen, to those who don't love us, who don't like us, God has called us, amen, to be a witness. And you know, one of the ways the Lord has shown me here recently to witness to people, to be able to talk to people, is to present them the facts. Plain the facts. You know, a lot of folks say, well, I don't believe the Bible. They say, I don't believe the Bible. A lot of folks may say, well, I don't believe in God, or I don't believe in Jesus. You may have folks that believe in God but don't believe in Jesus. Well, you can present the facts to these folks and you can say, look, you see this book, you see this Bible, it was written by dozens of different people over hundreds of years. Over hundreds of years this book was written, and it testified of one thing. It points to one thing, that Jesus is the Christ. He's the Son of God.
Amen.
He came to this world to die for our sin, that us believing on him might have life through him. So you can say that you don't, you have the right to say that you don't believe it. But I want you to know that these folks who wrote this book, they believe it.
Amen.
They believe it. God moved men by the Holy Spirit to pen down and to write these words. God moved men, and throughout all of this time, they prophesied of things that were going to happen, and these things came to pass.
Amen.
These things happened. They said that these things were going to happen, and then they did happen. They prophesied, they foretold through the Spirit of God the things that were going to happen.
Amen.
And they came to pass. And amen. So you can tell a person, you have that right. You have the very right to say that you don't believe it, but these folks believe it. And also do many millions of people throughout this time that God has given his word, that this book has withstood the test of time.
Amen.
Amen. It has been around for thousands of years. William Tyndale, a man, was actually choked to death and burned at the stake for translating this book from Latin. He was choked to death and was burned at the stake. And he prayed when he was burned at that stake and choked to death. He said, God, open the king's eyes. The king's eyes were opened, and it wasn't too long, and they began printing a Bible in English that people could be able to read. A man died. Many men have died. They believe this.
Amen.
So you can say that you don't believe it, but in so doing, you're saying that these men were wrong who died for the Word of God. In so doing, you're saying that these men were wrong who penned down the Word of God and who wrote and were inspired by the Holy Spirit to write the Word of God. So let me ask you, you can say to this person, let me ask you, if you're right and you go to church and you give God a chance, brethren, I do believe that you need to be in church. Amen. We need to go to church. Forsake not the assembly of yourselves, as the manner of some is, but exhort one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. Brother, the coming together of God's people, it exhorts us. It encourages us. Brother, to gather in his name, and brother, you can worship the God, you can worship God Almighty in spirit and truth. You can worship him on the telephone, you can worship him in your home, you can worship him at your kitchen table,
Amen.
You can worship him at the foot of your bed,
Amen.
And that's a blessing, brother, but God has given us the privilege to gather together in his name. The Bible says that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. And how shall they hear without a preacher?
Amen.
And how shall they preach except they be sent?
Amen.
Amen. And as it is written, blessed are the feet that bring glad tidings of good things. Amen. Hallelujah. That's the gospel.
Amen.
So glory be to God. You can say to this person, you can say, what do you have to lose by believing?
Amen.
You can say, look, what do you have to lose by giving God a chance? You lose a little bit of time. You come to church. You give the Lord an opportunity to prove you that he's true.
Amen.
Give him all taste and see that the Lord is good.
Hallelujah.
Give him just a chance, an opportunity. Now, brother, I mean, all of these people that's pinned down the Word of God, people who have died for the Word of God, Jesus who died on the cross, brother, don't you at least owe it that much? Just to give it a chance. Just to see if it's really true or not. And say, well, brother, what do you have to lose? A little bit of time and maybe a little bit of pride. Now, a lot of folks, they're concerned about what their friends or their neighbors might say about them coming to church, about them being seen with people who carry a Bible, Christians. And a person might lose a little bit of time, and they might lose a little bit of pride. But let me ask you this. Let me ask you this. What do you have to lose if everybody's right? All these people that wrote the Bible are right. All these folks who have been going to church, and all these folks that's been trying to get you to come to God, if they're right, what do you have to lose? Look, you're gambling with eternity.
Blessing, Lord.
You're gambling with it. You might lose a little time and you might lose a little pride if you go and you give the Lord a chance. You might lose a little time and you might lose a little pride if you're not convinced. But glory be to God, if everyone's right, you'll lose eternity.
Amen.
Eternity. Forever. Forever and ever. Listen, today is the day of salvation.
Amen.
Today is the time to be saved.
Amen.
Now is the time to be saved. Peter put it in words. He says that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. This is the day of salvation. Jesus has given us 2,000 years. Amen. Since the time that he came, he has given. God is not slack concerning his promises, but is long suffering toward usward, that all should come to repentance. He's not willing that any would perish.
Amen.
But that all would come to repentance. That's why God has tarried so long. Brother, the day of the Lord is at hand.
Amen.
It's coming. Jesus is coming. We've seen about the tribulation time, that the things that are going to be going on in the tribulation time, that there's going to be great famines. Amen. Even the Bible told us in the book of Amos that there's going to be a famine, not necessarily of bread or wine. He said that there's going to be a famine of hearing of the word of God.
Right.
There's coming a famine. Brother, there's going to be a famine when it costs a day's wages to buy a loaf of bread.
Amen.
There's coming a time, brother, when the Holy Spirit is going to be taken out of here.
Amen.
And we're going to be taken out of here with
Amen.
Him. There's going to be strong delusion upon this world, and the folks who have rejected Christ are going to accept a false Messiah.
That's right.
They will accept the Antichrist because he will do signs and wonders.
Yeah.
The false prophet will call down fire out of heaven, and he will the world will flock after him. And brother, they'll be deceived, and they'll receive a mark in their forehead or in their hand. And brother, all that receive the mark in their forehead or in their hand will not be those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Amen.
God's wrath is going to be poured out on this world because they would not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. But there's the day of the Lord will come when his wrath is in his in its fullness. And that's what we're going to look at today in Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. And I'm going to simply read from Revelation chapter 7 and 8 and 9. And I'm also going to read a couple other scriptures from Revelation. And you can't add anything to the Word of God.
Amen.
Brother, the Bible says that if we add anything to it or take anything from it, then the Bible says that the curses of this book will be added to that man. But glory be to God, I'm glad for that what the Lord has saved us from. Again, those that are saved are not appointed unto wrath. These things that we've seen, these famines, this deception, will be in heaven. We'll be receiving rewards. God will be appointing us and telling us what we're going to be doing in His kingdom. I'm looking forward
bless
to that
the
day.
Lord.
I think that there's going to be things that that folks are going to be sorry for the things that they have not done as Christians. But I think also that God is gracious and He's merciful. And I believe that God's going to reward us for things that we won't even think that we should deserve a reward. That God's going to say, well, you were faithful in this little thing that I gave you. I told you to go and you went. Now, Lord, I don't feel like I did much. The Lord's going to say, you were faithful in a few things. I'm going to make you ruler. And we're going to say, Lord, I don't feel like I deserve it. And God's going to smile. Hallelujah. Isn't it going to be wonderful? Amen. We have a serve a gracious Savior. You know, that's what grace is. It's unmerited favor.
Amen.
And I'm looking forward to that day. I'm looking forward to it. Glory be to His name. Revelation 7 says, and after these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and they were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. So here he's going to seal these tribes of the children of Israel upon the earth. They're upon the earth, 144,000. Of the tribe of Judah were sealed 12,000. And of the tribe of Reuben were sealed 12,000. And of the tribe of Gad were sealed 12,000. And of the tribe of Asher were sealed 12,000. And the tribe of Nephtalim were sealed 12,000. And of the tribe of Manasseh were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Simeon were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Levi were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Issachar were sealed 12,000. And of the tribe of Zebulun were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Joseph were sealed 12,000. And of the tribe of Benjamin were sealed 12,000. And he says, and after this, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne, before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. Now who is that? This is of all nations, kindreds, and tongues before the throne. So here we see that all nations, now this is not necessarily Israel, because he said of all nations, kindreds, and people. So here we see the Gentiles who are saints, washed out white and with the robe of God, amen, with God's righteousness. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God which sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God. Now look with me, if you would, at the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel chapter 9. You see here in Ezekiel chapter 9 that there is a judgment coming. God wants to seal those who are His people, so that they are protected from the wrath that is to come. Now the Bible says in Romans chapter 11 that blindness in part has happened unto Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. So Israel right now is blind to who Jesus is. They have not accepted him. They will be those that are deceived during the tribulation time. But there will be those whose eyes are opened. God's people, Israel, their eyes will be opened during the tribulation time. God will seal them to protect them from his wrath that is to come before this seventh seal is opened. Now there will be tribulation that they go through. There will be many that will be beheaded for the gospel's name's sake, for God's name's sake, for Jesus' name. There will be those that refuse to accept the mark of the beast. But here in Ezekiel we see a type. We see a type of what will happen in Revelation. And he cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate which lieth toward the north, every man with a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one man among them was clothed with linen, with a writer's inkhorn by his side. And they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. And the glory of God of Israel was gone up from the cherub whereupon he was to the threshold of the house. And he called the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's inkhorn by his side. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city and through the midst of Jerusalem and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. Brother, I want you to know that this world is going to be full of abominations during the tribulation time. Even as it is today, there's many things that are wicked in this world, but when the Holy Spirit's gone, it's going to be even worse.
Amen.
And the Bible says in the others, and to the others he said in mine ear, go ye after him through the city and smite. Let not your eyes spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. And he said unto them, defile the house and fill the courts with the slain. Go ye forth. And they went forth and slew in the city. And it came to pass that while they were slaying them, I was left, and I fell upon my face and cried and said, O Lord God, wilt thou destroy all the residue of Israel and pouring out thy fury upon Jerusalem? Then said he unto me, the iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceeding great. And the land is full of blood, and the city full of perverseness. And they say, the Lord hath forsaken the earth, and the Lord seeth not. And as for me, mine eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity, but I will recompense their way upon their head. And behold, the man clothed with the linen, which had the inkhorn by his side, reported the matter, saying, I have done as thou hast commanded me. So we see that God sealed those people who cried, who were because of the abominations, because of the sin. I believe the very same thing will happen in the time of the tribulation, that the God's people will cry out to him, that they will ask God for help, ask God for mercy. They're going to see that the church is gone. They're going to see that the things that Paul wrote and that Peter wrote are true in the New Testament. Their eyes are going to be opened. They are going to be provoked to jealousy.
Yeah.
And they're going to call on Jesus.
Right.
They're going to realize that who the false Messiah is. Their eyes are going to be opened. Yeah. And they're going to call on Jesus.
Praise
God. God's going to seal them. God's going to seal them. He's going to seal 144,000. And glory be to God. The Bible says here, he says, in Revelation chapter 7, and one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes? And whence came they? And he said unto me, sir, thou knowest. And he said, these are they which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them, and they shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. Neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. In chapter 8, the Bible says, and when he had opened the seventh seal, There was silence in heaven about the space of a half an hour. And when I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets, and another angel came and stood at the altar having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense that he should offer the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. And seven angels which had the seven trumpets appeared themselves to sound. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood. And they were cast upon the earth. And the third part of trees was burnt up, and all the green grass was burnt up. And the second angel sounded as it were a great mountain burning with fire, and was cast in the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood. And the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. And the third part sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star is called Wormwood, and the third part of the waters became wormwood. And many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Now I want you to know that these things about Hollywood, about that people think that they're going to send something and they're going to be able to stop a meteor that comes in at Armageddon. Brother, I tell you, you're not going to stop the wrath of God.
Amen.
There's nothing that's going to stop it. It's going to come. There's no technology. There's no amount of man's knowledge or wisdom that's going to be able to stop it, because it's going to come, brother. And glory be to God. The Bible tells us here that it's coming to this earth. And the Bible says, and the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars. So as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the voices of the trumpet of the three angels are yet to sound. Brother, I want you to know that Jesus, that during this time, we will be in heaven. We will be with God, and He will appoint us to what we're going to be doing in His time. And the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 19 about how that we're going to be with Him in the marriage supper of the Lamb. Revelation 19, it tells us that after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God.
Amen.
Now these people are in heaven, the Bible says.
Amen.
Not upon the earth. These people are in heaven. For true and righteous are His judgments, for He hath judged the great whore which did corrupt the earth with her fornication, and hath avenged the bloods of her servants at her hand. And again they say, Alleluia, and her smoke rose up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four beasts fell down and worshiped God that sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Alleluia. And a voice came out of the throne, saying, Praise our God, all ye His servants, and ye that fear Him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of great multitude, and the voice of many waters, and the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to Him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His wife hath made herself ready. And her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And He saith unto me, Write, for blessed are they which are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And He saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God. And I fell at His feet to worship Him. And He said unto me, See thou do it not, for I am thy fellow servant and thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. He goes on and he says, And I saw heaven opened, and behold a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war, and his eyes were the flame of fire, and his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed and fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he shall tread at the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The Bible goes on here in Revelation 9. The Bible says that a fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven upon the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose smoke out of the pit, and a smoke of great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth that have power. And he commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing nor any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. In those days shall men seek death and shall not find it.
Amen.
And shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle. And their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hairs, and hair was the hair of a woman, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. And they had breastplates, as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings were the sound of chariots of many horses running into battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and their stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue his name is Apollyon. One woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar which is before God, saying, the sixth angel which had the trumpet, loose one of the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, and which were prepared for an hour and a day, and a month and a year, to slay the third part of men. And the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000,000, and I heard the number of them. And thus I saw the horses in the vision, and them that sat on them, having breastplates of fire, and jacinth, and brimstone, and the heads of the horses were as the heads of lions. And out of their mouths issued fire and smoke and brimstone. By these three was the third part of men killed, by the fire, and by the smoke, and by the brimstone which issued out of their mouths. And their power is in their mouth and in their tails, and their tails like unto serpents, and had heads, and with them that do hurt. And the rest of the men were killed not by these plagues, and yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk. Neither repented they of their murders, nor for their sorceries, nor for their fornication, nor for their thefts. So there's going to be this great wrath that's poured out upon the world. There's going to be this great wrath. The Bible says that Christ himself, there in Revelation 19, is going to tread the winepress of the wrath of Almighty God. The Bible says here that men are going to seek death, but death will flee from them.
Amen.
Instead, they'll be tormented. They'll be tormented day and night upon this earth. They won't even be able to die. The Bible says here that they are not going to repent. You see that there's going to be people who simply are going to blaspheme, and they're going to hate God, and they're going to blame God for the things that are being done. But the truth of the matter is that they have rejected Jesus.
Yeah.
God is a merciful God. God's mercy endures forever.
Amen.
When we are in heaven, when we rule upon this earth with Christ, whether it be there, whether it be here, God's mercy endures forever. The reason we are saved is by God's mercy. It's not by anything good that we've done. And if there's anything today that folks need to understand, that it's not by our works of righteousness which we have done, but by His mercy that God saves us. But here we see that God is God's mercy. We see that God's opportunity for men to be saved is past. I don't believe that people will even seek to be saved. I believe that people will be so strongly deceived that the Bible, as the Bible says, that they will they'll not repent of their works. The Bible says that in Revelation 14 that he looked, and lo, a lamb stood on Mount Zion, with him 144,000 having his Father's name written in their foreheads. Now here, this is upon the earth. This isn't in the sky. This is on the earth.
Amen.
And he says, and I heard a voice of heaven as a voice of many waters, and the voice of a great thunder, and I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung, as it were, a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and elders, that no man can learn but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. They have what, these are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, and being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, and they were without fault before the throne of God. And every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God, and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him that made heaven and earth and sea and the foundations of waters. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations to drink the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehand or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And their smoke and their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And he said, and I heard a voice of heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. We also see over in Revelation chapter 16, the Bible tells us about the wrath that will be poured out upon the earth. He says that I heard a great voice out of the temple saying unto the seven angels, go your ways and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. Brother, this is just literally a wrath that we cannot even imagine, that we can simply see by what God tells us, these things that are going to come to pass. And he says that the first went and poured out his vial upon the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon men which had the mark of the beast and which worshipped his image. And the second angel poured out the vial of his wrath upon the sea, and it became as the blood of a dead man. And every living soul died in the sea. And the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and the fountains of waters, and they became blood. And I heard the angel of the waters say, thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and wast, and shall be, because thou hast judged thus. Now, amen. I'm so glad that God's righteousness is just.
Amen.
God's judgment is just.
Amen.
God is a just God. He has given men opportunity after opportunity today to receive Jesus as their Savior. God has given the opportunity for men to call upon him while God is near. And here, brother, the church has been taken away. The Holy Spirit has been taken away. Brother, a great tribulation. Men's hearts have become so hardened that they will not repent whatsoever of their deeds or of their works. The Bible goes on and it says in verse 8 that the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and power was given unto him to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat, and they blasphemed the name of God, which hath power over these plagues. And they repented not to give him glory. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seed of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain. And they blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds. Now, brother, men are going to be so greatly deceived, as I've said, that they will not repent. But as the Bible tells us, God's mercy endures. Had a man here repented, and a man said, "Lord, have mercy on me," I believe God would have mercy. But men's hearts are going to be so hardened, as they even are today, they're going to be so hardened that they'll not say, "Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, show me your mercy." Their hearts will be hardened. Brother, the Bible goes on and it tells us that the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. They are the miracle, the spirits of devils, working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and to the whole world, to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. And he gathereth them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. So we see that God's wrath is going to pour out upon this world. That God's tribulation is going to pour out upon this world. It is not a popular topic. But brother, it will come to pass. It is written in God's word. Just as it was prophesied that Jesus would come. Just as it was prophesied that they would pull his bones out of joint. Just as it was prophesied that they would cast lots for his vesture, that they would gamble for his clothes. Just as it was prophesied he would be born in Bethlehem.
Amen.
Just as it was prophesied that he would take the seed of God and he would put a division between Satan's seed and the woman's seed. And it came to pass. This will come to pass. This will happen. God's wrath will be poured out upon this earth. The Bible says that the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a voice out of the temple of heaven and from the throne, saying, "It is done." And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake such was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came into remembrance before God to give unto her cup the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And then there fell upon men great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great. I'm so thankful today for the salvation of our God.
Amen.
I'm so thankful for what God has given us to deliver us from wrath to come. It is a wonderful thing to be saved. Brother, I don't ever want to grow complacent with the salvation of our Lord. Because, brother, today is the day that the world needs to see a difference in us. We must take every opportunity and constantly seek the Lord for how we may be able to tell someone about the salvation of Jesus.
Yes,
I would not that anyone would have to go through this.
Yes,
but there will be multitudes upon multitudes that will go through it because God said that they would. And brother, I would not that anybody would have to go through this. The Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 3, what a blessing. The Bible says that be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandment of the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts. There are going to be people, you know just as well as I do, I pray that people that hear this sermon, that they will realize if they're a scoffer and they're a mocker. Because there are people who scoff and they mock and they laugh at this that God prophesies. But brother, I want you to know that there's going to come a day, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, that God's going to laugh.
Amen.
That God himself is going to laugh at those that say, Lord, that have mocked God, the Bible tells us. Let's just look there real quickly in Proverbs chapter 3 about how God said what God said would happen. Bless his holy name. I'm thankful, amen, that the Lord gives us these scriptures so that we can know, amen, as our sister said, that the knowledge of the truth is what helps us. Amen. God himself, the Bible, is going to laugh. He's going to have this world in derision, the Bible says. Here it is, it's in Proverbs chapter 1, that wisdom, in verse 20, wisdom crieth without, she uttereth her voice in the street, she crieth in the chief place of concourse, in the openings of the gates. In the city she uttereth her words, saying, how long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity? And the scorners delight in their scorning, and fools hate knowledge. Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you, and will make known my words unto you, because I have called, and ye refused. I have stretched out my hands, and no man regarded. But ye have said it not all my counsel, and I would none of my reproof. I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. For they hated knowledge, and did not choose the fear of the Lord. They would none of my counsel. They despised all my reproof. Therefore shall they eat of the fruit of their own way, and be filled with their own devices. For the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. But whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil. You know, us as Christians, we don't fear death.
Listen, Lord. Yeah.
We don't fear death. These things that were happening this past week with the tornadoes and the storms and everything, brother, yes, it's powerful. And amen. Brother, it made me think of how great thou art.
Hallelujah.
I see the stars and I hear the rolling thunder. Amen. Thy power throughout the universe displayed.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Brother, I want you to know my God is in control.
Amen.
And if God wants to take me out of here, brother, there's no fear in him. The fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. You don't have to fear death. Brother, us as Christians, we don't fear death and we rejoice in life. Amen. Glory be to God for what he has given us.
Hallelujah.
We know that there's going to be scoffers and mockers walking after their own lust, but God is going to mock when their fear comes. God is going to laugh when their calamity comes. The Bible says that these scoffers and mockers will say in 2 Peter chapter 3, that they will say, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the creation. For this they willingly, there's people who are willingly ignorant.
Sure.
For thus they are willingly ignorant of that by the word of the Lord the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. But the heavens and the earth are now by the same word kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. There are those who willingly will say, I don't even want to give God a chance. I don't even want to give God an opportunity. They would just simply say, I don't believe it. I'm not even going to look at it. I'm not going to listen to it. You are willingly willingly ignorant. You are willingly rejecting Jesus Christ. That is why God will pour out his wrath upon this world.
Bless him, Lord.
People willingly choose this way. Now I want you to know there's coming a new heaven and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. There is not going to enter in anything that worketh an abomination or maketh a lie. God is not going to allow that willing sin to enter in to his kingdom. He will not allow it. Aren't you glad? I'm glad for the things that aren't going to be in heaven. Amen. The Bible says that, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, we're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness.
Praise God.
Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found in him in peace, without spot, and blameless. Brother, we are to be found in Jesus. There's no more important thing in this world for you to know that your heart is right with God, to know that you're saved, and that God has not appointed unto you wrath,
amen,
but salvation. The Bible says in John 3:36, that he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. God's wrath will abide. If you want to understand a little about God's wrath, you can look at the cross. And you can see God's wrath. God hates sin so much,
amen,
that he allowed his Son to be tortured, literally tortured, that he hung on that cross half naked in front of people as they mocked him and cursed him. And he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. God has a right to be angry with sin. God has a right. God is a righteous judge. When God destroys this world, when people small and great, young and old, perish in this wrath to come, it will be righteous. It will be a righteous judgment. The world sees this and they say, well, how can God be righteous? God has given everyone an opportunity to have everlasting life through his Son. God has given everyone this opportunity. If you don't know that you're saved, you can simply believe on the Son of God. You can simply believe and trust him as your Savior, amen, and be saved. It's as simple as that.
Amen.
It's not complex. Amen. Oh, God's as deep as you want to go, but his salvation is for those, though the wayfaring man, though fools, shall not err therein. It's for anyone,
amen,
who will receive it. And I'm thankful for that today. Let us all pray together. Father Almighty, we thank you, my Savior God, for what you've given us. We thank you, Father God, Lord, for sending your Son to die on the cross for us, Lord God. And Lord God, we know that he's coming, dear Lord God, that he'll come. Dear Lord God, as a lightning shineth from the east to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be, Father. And Lord God, we thank you that, dear Lord, you've not appointed us unto this wrath, the day of the Lord that'll come. But Lord God, you've given us your salvation. And Father, we praise you for that, Father. And Lord, we just ask that you might help us, Father. Lord, that we might bring honor and glory to your name, that we might witness, dear Lord, to our families, witness to those that are out of the ark of safety and out of the sheepfold, Father. And Lord God, that we might help Compel those, dear Lord God, to come into your house and to hear of the goodness of who Jesus is. Father, thank you for loving us and thank you for saving us, Father, for giving your Son. Dear Lord, we pray today in the name of Jesus, the name above every name. In Jesus' name we pray.
The living word.
Thank you.
It lives on forever and ever. And you live on forever and ever. And thank you, God, that your mercy endureth forever.
Well, we've made it through the tribulation. We've made it through the rapture, the tribulation, and the day of the Lord, the second coming of Christ. And after this will come God's kingdom set up upon this earth.
Amen.
Right. Amen. We're not done yet. Hallelujah. The Lord's got a lot of things in store for us.
Amen.
The millennial reign. I talked to a fellow the other day, and I never heard about that. I never heard about a 1,000 years on this earth. It's in the Bible.
Amen.
It's in the Bible. Amen. And that brother, I'm glad for the word of God, because God said, "O Lord, thy word is forever settled in heaven."
Amen.
This book, brother, God's word, Jesus, the word of God, is forever settled in heaven. I'm glad for what he has given us, and I'm thankful, amen, that Jesus is coming soon.
Amen.
And you know, brother, the sinners should fear today if they're not right. They should fear when they hear these things that are going to come to pass in the book of Revelation. They should fear, and they should turn their hearts over to God, and God will take care of that fear.
Amen.
God will take care of that fear. Isn't it good to be saved?
Yes.
Anybody have a song request that we can sing for closing?
How about what a day that will be?
Amen. Amen.
Page 24 in the red book.
Did you say what? What did you say?
24 in the red book.
There is coming a day when the heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Well, anybody have anything that you want to add to the service?
Sister Imogene to sing a song I think everybody knows.
And then.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. And many more. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Birthdays to you. Many more birthdays to you. Many more birthdays, God bless you. Many more birthdays to you.
Yeah. Thank you all. I love you all, and I'm thankful for you. You are precious. I'm really thankful for it. The Lord has allowed us all to come together. Each one of you means so much to me. I'm thankful for it. Thankful for you. You ready to praise the Lord?
He is.
Amen. After we get done praising the Lord, we want to talk about something. There's something the Lord's laid on our heart to discuss, and just want to talk about before everybody goes their different ways. Brother Jim, would you lead us?
Praise the Lord for His mercy and endureth forever. Praise the Lord for His mercy and endureth forever.
Sunday night again, and it wouldn't be dark then, would it? Well, okay. Well, let's pray about it, and we'll let the Lord lead us.
All right,
yeah.
Camcorder.
Oh yeah.
So,
you know, Brother Mark, Jim's telling me about Brother Mark preaching and things. We need to remember Brother Mark preaching out there. Mount Tabor. Yeah, I love Brother Mark. You know Mark here.
Yeah, I heard him back here praising the Lord. Now he's one of God's praise and worship for things.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he ain't a bit of shame.
I remember about him talking about building that house and all that and back there and what all God had done and
bless the Lord.
I heard him preach one time and I said, let me tell you what, I said, that man right there would make a great evangelist.
Oh, bless the Lord.
Because I said, he can preach it, but I said, you could feel the hell.
Bless the Lord.
We could support. You know, that's why I was saying it was in a revival. Never seen that man before in my life. And he preached that hellfire and brimstone. Let me tell you, I was over there before I get to find that chair.
Amen.
Next thing I know, when he was finished, I don't remember what the man looked like, but I heard the word.
Amen.
And let me tell you, I was up and on my knees. And as I raised up this yellow piece of paper, she said, what is your name?
Well.
And at that same time, I said, my name is being written somewhere else.
Hallelujah.
And I wrote that little yellow piece of paper.
Oh, amen. Amen.
Well, that's your sweetheart.
All righty, y'all be careful. Love y'all.
You know, I think I do have a book that goes with that.
Really? Well,
bless
the Lord. Oh, yeah, we'll all watch this together, whole family.
Yeah, though.
Matter of fact, I'm going out to Mom and Dad's today, and we might be able to watch it out there with Mom and Dad, too.
It's snowing. Happy birthday to you. You live in a zoo. You act like a monkey. And
to.
Yeah. Well, there is flurries flying around, isn't there?
Y'all
be safe. Have a good week.
Whoop, whoop, whoop. Doot, doot, doot. Hurry up in there. I got to go. Doot, 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 doot.
Y'all be safe.
Hey, Mom,
I will.
Happy birthday to you.
Okay, love y'all.
You live in a zoo. Happy birthday to you. You smell like a monkey. And you
act
like one, too.
Bring tissues, please get them.
Happy birthday to you. You live.